to talk in the previous session, I think it will be a good idea if I talk less and demonstrate something which is really very interesting. Basically, I'm a physics teacher from India, and I would like to share a few things in the beginning before I begin with the story of Python in my class. The place from where I come, and maybe almost everywhere, science is generally taught from the textbooks without giving much importance to the experiments. And maybe because of that, students fail to relate what they learn in the classroom to their real life. And most of the times when we ask questions to students, generally they feel physics to be the most boring and most difficult subject. Most boring maybe because of teachers like us, and most difficult maybe because we are not able to give the real picture, a real conceptual model. We are not able to convince that model to the students. In the beginning, maybe we should discuss something about this. This is the real situation almost everywhere. We give too much importance to the theory and very less importance to the experimental part of it. And if we have a vehicle which is made of these kind of wheels, and you know where that vehicle will head to, it goes nowhere. Basically, in my class, the problems which I faced were related to these concepts. Concepts of electricity, where we teach students AC and DC, the differences between them. And everything is actually taught only from the textbooks. Students really do not know what is the real difference between alternating current and a direct current. Then electromagnetic induction. Students just mug up Faraday's laws. They are good at it, reproduce, and get good marks in the examination. But if you ask them to demonstrate Faraday's law using some simple equipments, they fail. And they fail to apply this understanding to some real-life situations. Same story is true with interference of sound. Now, interference of sound, there is too much complicated mathematics behind it. We draw waveforms on the board, we show superposed waveforms, and in the end, nobody understands anything. So I was thinking, how about demonstrating these things to the students, or give students some small educational tools so that they can play around with it, they can learn by doing something, learn by exploring and experimenting. And this problem was almost solved by Python and XPIES. XPIES stands for Experiments for Young Engineers and Scientists. The name is XPIES. And with a very simple code, which you can see on the screen, just import the Python library, write two lines of a code, capture a waveform, and display it. Basically, what this program does is, it can fetch the data using that XPIES box. You can connect any source, alternating current or source of direct current, and you can actually plot those curves, and you can demonstrate what is the difference between the two. As I told you earlier, it will be a good idea if I show you something first and then I'll again come back to this presentation. Basically, I'm talking about, am I audible there?
Yes.
Okay, I'm talking about this box. A very small box, we call this as XPIES, a pocket size lab, and it's all open source. The hardware and also the software framework is all open. I'll be using this to demonstrate few things. For example, if I want to demonstrate electromagnetic induction, what we need is, we need two pickup coils. Just one pickup coil will also do. And then, changing magnetic field. As we all know, if we keep a conductor in a variable magnetic field, electricity is induced in that conductor. There is a generation of electromagnetic EMF. This thing can be demonstrated very easily using coil and LED and a DC motor and a magnet. But then, to see what kind of waveform you are getting, we need to fetch the data and plot it on a screen. And Python makes this job really very easy with just 3-4 lines of code.
It's
the main GUI for accessing all the controls and terminals of XSPICE. This is like your four-channel oscilloscope. Now, if you want to demonstrate all these basic physics and electronics experiments, what are the things we need? We need a good quality oscilloscope. We need function generator. We need power supplies. We need digital analog meters. We need so many other instruments. And from the place where I come, these things are not affordable. And at most of the places, students get to know about a laboratory and get hands-on in the laboratory only when they come to 11th standard. Till 10th standard, they study everything from the textbooks. And that was the real problem we thought of helping the students with. And the result is this kit. Here we have four channels, A1, A2, In1, In2. And these can be plotted here on the main screen. So what I'll do is, I'll take the sine terminal from this XSPICE box. There is one inbuilt sine terminal which can generate a sine wave. Maybe I'll explain that box little detail in the end. I'll connect that sine wave to A1 channel of XSPICE. So what I'm basically doing is, I'm creating a sine wave and I'm plotting that sine wave here on the screen. And here you have all the terminals that you have with a good digital storage oscilloscope. The program which I have shown you in the beginning, just capture time and voltage and plot and show. It was a three-line code. And with the three-line code, I could give AC current to one terminal of this box and I could plot that graph. If you do the same thing with a DC battery, you will get a straight line and you will be able to measure the voltage of that. You can also measure the frequency here with a very simple command, again using a Python code. You can just save it and you will get the frequency of this signal. Frequency is about 150 Hz. Let us do one more simple experiment. What I'll do now is, I'll use this DC motor. Idea was using homemade equipments, low-cost sensors and homemade equipments, and do all sorts of experiments. I'm using a DC motor and this is a neodymium magnet. I'll fix this neodymium magnet on the motor and I'll power this motor using an external battery, a small 3-volt battery. It can be powered using this box also. Now, the magnet on the motor is rotating. And as a result, I have a changing magnetic field here. Now what I'll do is I'll take these pickup coils. These are simple coils. You can just take insulated copper wire and have winding of copper wire on paper cylinder. Have 1000 or 1500 turns and the coil is ready. So I'll connect this coil to A1, that is the channel of this box, and ground. So the circuit is complete. And now I'll simply bring this coil close to this moving magnet. Right, can you see a wave is generated there? Now if I bring this coil very close, the amplitude of the wave increases, and if I take that coil away, amplitude decreases. Now I did some simple experiments in the beginning. I gave this box and I just demonstrated these things to 9th and 10th standard students. And there is one more problem that we face. We have vernacular medium students. They study up to 10 in Marathi or Kannada language. And when they come to 11th for science, the first problem is understanding English and the second problem is understanding science. So what I did, I just demonstrated these simple things without using any scientific term, and I gave these boxes to those 10-15 kids. Asked them to do such kind of experiments at home and come back after 10 days. And when they come back after 10 days, I started asking them questions. What happens when you bring the coil close to the magnet? The answer was ready. What is the reason for this? What happens if you just insert that screwdriver in the coil? Answer was ready. And then I just put the same terms on the board in English language using scientific terms, and they were ready with all the answers. So what I'll do now is, I'll take one more coil here. Maybe we can try one more simple experiment. If I just place this screwdriver in the coil, you can see the magnitude increases. And if I remove that screwdriver, magnitude of the signal decreases. In almost all the transformers, we use ferroelectric core. If you insert a ferroelectric rod here, amplitude of the signal increases. Let us take one more coil. One more very difficult concept for teachers and also students is phase. single phase AC, two phase AC, three phase AC, what is the phase difference? So that can be very easily demonstrated here. For this, I'll use one more coil. Connect this to second channel of this box, and one terminal will go to ground. And here, I'll select the second channel. This is A2. I'll just drag it to channel 2. So I'm plotting two signals on the same screen now. This is the first signal generated by the first coil. And here we have second signal generated by the second coil. The red signal and there's one black signal. Now, if I hold these coils like this, can you see that they are almost in phase? They are changing in a similar fashion. Crest of one wave falls on the crest of the other. Now, if I rotate one coil, if I rotate one coil by say 180 degrees, like this, now you can see the signals are exactly out of phase, right? So there is a phase difference introduced between the waves. If I just move these coils and hold them at 90 degrees, you have two signals which are different in phase by 90 degrees. Like that, a very simple experiment can demonstrate almost everything related to phase of AC, Faraday's laws, and basic ideas of electromagnetic induction. There is one more thing that we can very easily do. Generally, all these AC lines, now we have power cables here, these also radiate energy. And that can be easily catched and you can plot that signal here on the screen. For that, what I'll do is, I'll just connect one simple wire to any one channel. Let us delete one channel so it will be easy for us to see. Right? There is only one black line. I have not connected any source of electricity to the terminal. It's just one small wire hanging here. Now, if I just change this time scale setting and if I touch this, can you see that signal's amplitude is increased? If I leave it, it's plain, and if I just touch it, right? And if you just find out the frequency of this, it's 49.950 Hz. I think that is the frequency of AC in Singapore, right? That is AC radiated by these power lines, and when I touch this terminal here, my body is acting like an antenna and it is picking up the signal. And therefore, when I leave it, the signal is weak, and if I hold it, like that, many simple things can be demonstrated. Maybe we should have one more experiment and then I'll just come to the slides. Sorry, I'm talking too long. Demonstrating interference of sound is a little difficult thing. But with the help of XPIES box, it's really very easy. Ready-made experiments given here. Since the design and the code, everything is open, anybody can design new experiments. If you know basics of Python and if you spend few days with this code, you can design your own experiments. I'll select this interference of sound. Again, this GUI is written with a very simple code in Python. So what I have done now is, I have connected two simple buzzers like this. In India, they are available for 5-10 rupees. It's a very low cost device. And that AC circuitry is removed. So I'm connecting two buzzers to two sources here. I have two sources of square waves. Square wave one, this is the source. Maybe it's a good idea to show you that. This is square one. And if I just drag it to channel one, you will get one square wave here. Let us enable that. This is square wave one. And I'll take one more source, square wave 2, and I'll display that on channel 2. So I have two square waves here. I'm going to feed these square waves to these buzzers. And let us see how that interference experiment works. Okay, so the idea is, drive one buzzer with one signal, second buzzer with the second signal and mix both the sounds. Now what happens when sound waves, when two sound waves are traveling in the same medium and when they superpose, at some places they come in phase, means crest of one wave falls on the crest of the other, and they superpose constructively. Amplitude of the sound should increase, and when they go out of phase, crest falls on the trough of the other, then they should destroy each other. And therefore, periodically, amplitude should increase, decrease, increase, decrease. That is the formation of beats. That is the interference of sound. That can be demonstrated really very easy here. Let us check these buzzers first. I'll enable SQR1 and I'll say start. There's a sound there. I'll just bring it close to the mic. Right, there is a signal there. This is signal generated by the first source. There is inbuilt mic here in the box. There is inbuilt amplifier, and that is fed to channel 1. Now let us test the second buzzer. This is a little weak. Maybe I'll change it. From the second one. Now you can see that the signal is almost uniform. The fluctuations which you are able to see are because of vibrations of my hand here. If I hold it very steadily, you will get the signal with constant amplitude, and if I just move it away, it decreases, move it closer, it increases. But roughly the amplitude is same almost everywhere. Now let us start both the signals simultaneously, and we'll pick up that sound with a single mic. That means two sound waves are mixed, and that wave will be plotting here. Can you see the wave is actually increasing and decreasing in the amplitude? When the waves come in phase, amplitude increases. When the waves go out of phase, amplitude decreases. So the simplest experiment that can demonstrate interference of sound, and after doing these kind of experiments, if we go to theory and show them the mathematical part of it, things will become very, very easy. Now let us talk about the project, just to give you a little idea about what it is and how it can help all the students to learn things in a positive way. Okay, so basically it is a low-cost device that can measure voltage as a function of time. And we have a built-in signal generator here. It gives a fixed value sine wave. There are two square wave generators. There is one amplifier. There are terminals for programmable voltage source. There is a terminal for constant current source. There are inbuilt terminals for accepting output from the sensor. So in short, it's a full-fledged physics electronics laboratory that every student deserves to have in his school bag. This is for teachers, students, and also for engineers and hobbyists. For students, it is affordable personal lab where they can carry it everywhere and they can try and do experiments at home. For teachers, it's a tool for demonstrating experiments in the classroom. And for engineers, this can behave like a, it can work like a test tool. This is what I was talking about. It is 12-bit analog input-output device. It can measure time intervals. And the minimum time interval that we can measure is 1 microsecond. And that's why any high-speed phenomena can be studied very easily using this tool. We have about 60 to 70 experiments ready, and because of contribution of many other volunteers, many new experiments are being added every day. Design is totally loyalty-free. There is a freedom to use this at various levels of sophistication. Level 1, you have ready-made GUI programs where a user need not have any idea about programming and coding. You can simply open that GUI. It is self-explanatory and circuit diagrams are also there, right? So using circuit diagram, you connect the circuit and just do the experiment. At level 2, you can access the programs, make small changes in the programs and start learning coding itself and design your own experiments. Okay, this was the earlier version of XPies that was little costly, and we tried to reduce the cost and also the size. Earlier design was based on Atmega microcontroller. Now we are using Microchip, PIC microcontroller, and as a result, the cost is extremely low. It is available in India for just less than 2,000 rupees. Maybe I do not know what is the Singaporean dollar equivalent. 2,000 rupees. I'm not actually marketing this product. I'm not advertising it. It's all open source. If anybody is interested, they can take the design from the site and they can manufacture it here also. Idea was to produce something which is very affordable to everyone. Communicating with XPies, it's a very simple program. Import XPies library, and there are ready-made function calls written. Using these function calls, you can read inputs and you can also produce outputs using the box. A very simple experiment that I have demonstrated in the beginning is the code. This is the main CRO screen. And let us take a look at what kind of experiments we can do. We can do experiments related to logic gates, digital ICs, interference of sound, transistor characteristics, acceleration due to gravity by time of flight, and there are many other experiments. Last year, I got opportunity to work with FOSS Asia for Google Summer of Code, and we could develop new experiments. We used SRF05 ultrasonic position sensor. There are some proprietary devices available in the market. To study Newton's laws, we need a system where vehicles can move without friction. We need air track for gliding motion. And to sense the position, we need some sophisticated sensors. And if you buy it from POSCO or Vernier, cost will be more than 2 lakh rupees in Indian currency. And with this project, we used a simple SRF05 sensor, which will cost about 100 rupees, about 2 Singaporean dollar. And there is one student who is studying in England. He prepared one air track and he kept the design open. Because of his contribution, we could produce the air track within just 3,000 rupees. And in 5,000 rupees, our entire setup was ready. So we can just compare 5,000 with more than 2 lakh. And that comes with a license, right? You need to buy that license every year. And here, this is open. This is released under GPL. We use simple DC motors as sensors, as pickup devices, and we could do coupled pendula experiment. Now doing coupled pendula experiment and fetching that data is a very costly affair. But here in 20-30 rupees, we could do that experiment with XPies. We also have designed a sine wave generator using ATtiny chip, which is a low cost chip. And using the square waves which are available in this box, this can generate 2 square waves. Those can be converted into sine waves. So in short, this simple box is a full-fledged lab with which one can do all sorts of experiments related to physics and electronics. When I say all sorts of, anything that can be converted into electrical signal, that experiment can be done with this box. Our friend Mr. George is helping us. He's at France, and because of his efforts, now XPies software is officially available in Ubuntu repository. Basically, this is our goal. Right now, cost is about $30. But this can be brought to just $1.5. Now, if you look at these equipments, both have similar hardware. The difference is manufacturing. If we are able to manufacture this in large quantity, we can definitely reduce the price. And if anyone is interested to have the dealership, or if anyone is interested to manufacture this and retail it or produce and sell, the only condition that we have is new development should be open source and everything must be released under general public license. Okay, this is the box it comes in along with XPI's main kit. You have all the basic accessories which enables you to do all basic experiments. Thank you for your patience. If you really have any questions, I would be more than happy to answer.
So, okay. So one question. So you have it's very nice to have a very cheap device like this, and you can actually, probably students themselves can afford to buy their own device.
Yeah.
Is in your place actually access to computers, laptops, is it a problem? Because
yeah, that is a big problem in our place. I would like to share that story also. I'm happy to see students from Denman High School. Is it Denman? Yeah. Last year we participated in Google coding program. I was one of the mentors with OS Asia, and I thought because I'm the mentor here, why not give our children a chance to participate and just give them the feel of learning something new, feel of learning coding. But unfortunately in the beginning, very few students turn up. I started spreading awareness about the program before the actual event started in the month of December last year. For 2-3 months, I used Facebook, I used my personal contacts, every class where I used to tell them about Google coding, I used to tell them about all the prizes which are involved. And then hardly 3-4 students could participate. And in the beginning, they were taking only very simple tasks like design a t-shirt, design a logo, but none could take a task involving programming in that. And then we started finding out the real problem. My mentor started asking me, in Google Summer of Code, maximum participants will be from India. For Google Summer of Code, that is for degree students, 18 plus students. And for Google Coding, hardly about 10-15 students participated. Then we asked the mentors, if you allow us to have direct interaction between the students. I think that mentor and mentee direct interaction was not allowed there on the site. We used to interact only on the web. And when that was allowed, we conducted a few workshops for the students. We started telling them everything from basic. In my region, hardly 1% students have access to computers. And hardly 1%, maybe less than that. In rural area, people have not even seen a computer. They get a chance to learn programming only in 11th standard. That too, if they take computer science as optional subject. In sciences, we have physics, chemistry, maths are compulsory subjects, and biology and computer science is optional. They can select, they can go for biology or for computer science. If they go for computer science, that time they start learning programming, and till today they are learning only C. So I thought of having some workshops, basic workshops on Python, basic workshops on, we even started with creating a Gmail account. Okay. Telling them how to start a computer. And every Sunday we had a workshop, on all holidays we had workshops, and during the Google coding session, every day in the evening we used to meet. And about 100 students participated, 78 students could complete the task, and our school was at the second position. First position was backed by Denman High School, Singapore, and second position in the entire world by my school. That was a very happy moment for us. Okay, if there is no other question, thank you very much. Before I conclude, I must thank Team PyCon Singapore and Ivan. He has given me this opportunity to be here, to be among you and learn something new from every one of you. Thank you so much.